What it do, baby? We back with another episode of Days in Quarantine. And first and foremost, thank all of you guys who are tuning in right now. Let me get my drink, because this... Oh. Lord of mercy, Lord of mercy. It's about to get very, 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 very real. So where do I even start with this? It's Easter Sunday. So glory be to God for another day. Glory be to God for health. I'm praying peace, I'm praying health, I'm praying safety over all of my friends and family out there. Even people who are just now tuning into this because they've come across the video. I'm praying, you know, health and prosperity over the world right now, because this situation is very real, it's very dire, and it's spiraling out of control. Granted, you know, the media is saying one thing and the media is trying to ease our fears and make us feel more confident in our government's ability to handle the situation, but the reality is our government had plenty of time to address the situation and remediate it or make it so it wasn't as dire and drastic, but they chose not to. So that to me says a lot about where, you know, the administration and the state and the cities priorities are as far as, you know, helping and protecting its people. So it's Easter Sunday. If you're watching this, you're alive to see another day. That's enough to feel blessed about. That's enough to feel, you know, grateful about today amidst everything that's happening. Now, it's been a few weeks, maybe like 1 or 2 weeks since I last dropped the video and I last, you know, touched base on how my quarantine life was going. And, you know, it is with unfortunate news that I have to announce that my grandmother passed away last Thursday from pneumonia. Now, you ask me, I'm gonna say it is COVID-19. It was the coronavirus, and that was what took her out. And that was Thursday, this is Sunday, it's only been a matter of days, and every day since then has been a roller coaster. You know, the first day was just like, it was traumatizing from the gate. And before, you know, I get into what life has been like since learning this news, let me take a step back and talk about what led up to my grandmother's passing, because it is only right and it is only fair that I give her a voice, that I, even though she was probably not included in those COVID-19 numbers on Thursday, which was the deadliest day for New York City, and then Friday also became a deadliest day, but that was the first deadliest day for New York. And unfortunately, I don't believe she'll be included in those numbers. Now, my grandmother never left her house. She was someone, she was 90 years old at that. She lived to be 90 years, which is a blessing in itself. So even though I'm struggling, I'm trying to see the good in it all. But, you know, she was 90 years old and she never left her house. So someone entering the house gave her something that was a pneumonia virus. Now, no one in the house had pneumonia, so that just goes to show you that likely someone who's asymptomatic probably passed on this virus. But nevertheless, let me take it back a couple of steps to talk about what kind of led up to her passing. Before her passing, around the time of my birthday, which was the end of March, I was informed that she was suffering from a fever, and for that reason, she was taken to the hospital. She was going to a local hospital, which all of the hospitals in the Bronx are pretty much not about shit, so there's that. And, you know, right now, people in lower income neighborhoods within New York City are suffering greatly, not because they're more susceptible to the virus, but because most of those people have pre-existing conditions that are driven by the systemic racism that exists that perpetuates bad health. That's gonna take a little bit to sink in, but let me explain. People in lower income neighborhoods tend to be on the front line, tend to be working essential jobs, and those are the people who are interacting with everyone else in the world who is asymptomatic or actually sick and still going out into the world. Now, taking it even further, you know, people usually in these neighborhoods, in these communities, have pre-existing health conditions because of the foods and the diets that they eat. Most people have low income, which means that they're not going to be spending their money on sweet green to get the best salads. They're not going to be investing their money in that way. They're going to be looking for the quick and easy and cheap food. Your bodegas, your McDonald's, your KFCs, your Popeyes. Those are the people eating those types of foods that we know are horrible for you, that we know have carcinogens in them, and that we know can cause other ailments such as diabetes, such as high blood pressure, and so forth, high cholesterol and all that stuff. So, you know, my grandmother, for the most part, she lived a very healthy life, but she was a smoker. And smoking led her to, in her later years, actually within the last couple of months, to have a stroke. That was the only bad health that she had, so she was definitely susceptible to something like COVID-19. She had a fever, she went to the local hospital, and they turned her away. They turned her away and told her to self-quarantine at home. That is what is happening in New York City. The media is saying, well, you know, we're not seeing as many hospitalizations, all of our incubators are not being used. Well, that's because people are being turned away. Not because people aren't sick. There are tons and tons and hundreds of people that are sick in the Bronx and Brooklyn and Queens that have low-income communities. So yes, that is a situation at hand. She was told to go home and self-quarantine where her condition, you know, worsened. She was so weak that she couldn't speak. She couldn't move, and she had a home attendant that was looking after her. But this situation is so traumatizing and devastating that it's tearing apart families, because when I got that news, I was faced with the decision of whether I, you know, possibly risk infecting her because she wasn't tested. That was something else that ticked me off. They didn't test her, so she's not included in the numbers from the gate. But because she wasn't tested, there's that ambiguity of whether she does have it or whether it's something else. And me, being someone who was actually exposed to the virus through a colleague, that's a whole different other story, I couldn't go and see her. And if the case was that she was sick, it's also petrifying because it's like, you can't go and even see your parent because you might become infected and die. So I had to live with not knowing what was going on, not being able to console her, not being able to comfort her, but resting on the fact that she was in her own house and she was somewhere comfortable. She wasn't left in an emergency room hallway to die. She wasn't in a nursing home alone. So those things gave me some comfort, but that was a situation. I was able to speak over the phone to her but not hear anything back because she was so weak, until Thursday, where, you know, I was informed via text that she had passed. And while I'm on the text, I'm also on a work Zoom call, and it's just like in the middle, like this is the life that we're living, where you're informed of someone's death as you're on a conference call with your colleagues. Like, that's life, because you can't be with them. So, you know, I was informed of her death, and the situation is so dire in New York City specifically, because the medical examiner took 12 hours to show up and take her body away. Not only that, family members, you know, what I will say is that by the grace of God, I do have certain family members that have been helping tremendously throughout this process and have been a key part of, you know, giving my grandmother the proper go away transition. By the grace of God, I haven't been going through this alone. My cousins Ron and Sean have done a tremendous, amazing job at making sure that my grandmother has been taken care of through life and afterlife. and they continue to do so. My grandmother would possibly still be alive if she had an IV to treat her, because she didn't have respiratory issues as much. Towards the end she did, but in the beginning that wasn't the real issue. She needed an IV, she needed nutrients, she needed vitamins, she wasn't eating. And the nurses that were coming to see her could only do but so much because they couldn't give her that treatment. And so, you know, the medical examiner took 12 hours to come and finally did. And where it stands now is the family can't grieve or mourn the way we are used to grieving and mourning. We can't have a funeral service to send our loved ones off to the next phase of eternal life. And to me, that's so devastating because I never would imagine that I wouldn't be able to have a proper service. Like, it's bad enough I didn't get to see her in those last days. So that's a conundrum, because it's like, do you bury the person and not have a service? Do you try to have a viewing and then bury them immediately? But the viewing is dependent upon the funeral home and their capacity. And you also have price gouging happening with the death care industry, where they're taking advantage of this situation to earn more money. And it's just so messed up. It's fucked up. And it's devastating. It is just like, it's so much to take in. And that's where I am right now. And I'm grieving at the same time and trying to work through these situations that are arising. But it's tough, and this COVID-19 thing is very real, and I just urge all of you to stay indoors, self-isolate, quarantine, stock up on your vitamins, your herbs, your teas. Like, make sure you're taking plenty of herbs, plenty of teas, the right teas, and just do what's right to take care of you and your family. So I wanted to share that with you guys as far as what I'm going through, how this has impacted me directly, and I'm staying strong. And just trying to think positive about, you know, the last time I saw my grandmother, which was her 90th birthday. And I threw her a celebration and some family members joined, and she was so happy then. She was so happy to see us. She was so happy to spend that time with us, to know that she was cared and loved for. And that brings me peace. And it's definitely impacted me directly, and I'm still going through it and still trying to get through it. I'm hopeful about the future, but you know, as of right now, things are tough. Things are definitely tough, but that's my life right now. And thank you to all the family, all the friends that have reached out, that have supported me. I definitely appreciate you all. I think this is bringing everyone together, and there is beauty in that unity. There's beauty in unity. There's beauty in togetherness. And that's something even I'm learning in my own introverted and isolated ways. I'm even learning that, and it's a beautiful thing. So continue to come together, continue to band together with strangers, with friends, loved ones. Continue to just bring each other together. And we will get through this. We will get through this. I'm very confident that we're gonna get through this with hopefully as little loss as possible, but that's all dependent upon us and whether we self-quarantine, whether we social distance and take care of ourselves. So shout outs to everyone, prayers up to everyone, prayers up to your families, prayers up to everyone who's on the front lines, who works in the healthcare industry, in any type of medical related field, everyone who's an essential worker right now. Just shout outs to all of you guys. We need you. You are the backbone of this economy. If nothing says that before, now you know. You guys are the backbone of this economy. You are the backbone of the livelihood and the future of this country. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I'm praying for everyone who's lost someone, and you know, stay tuned for the next episode where hopefully things are lighter. Hopefully there's, you know, positive progress that has been made, and we'll continue to have this conversation until we are out of this, because we're getting out of this. Cheers to that.